Yeah, hi. Some of you met me in the morning. I work in the data space for over 10 years, 12 years, 15 years. Currently co-founder for a startup, and also I advise companies on data science and building product consulting and technology consulting.
Hello, everyone. I'm Anand. I'm from Stomatobot Technologies. We want to meet CCTV surveillance for proactive mobile alerts in near real time. And I've been into the field of computer vision for about 6-7 years, I mean actually 10 plus years. I was introduced to this field by my seniors in similar kind of scenario or workshop, and I thought that I'll make a career out of this. And I hope many of you or most of you quit a career in computer vision, deep learning and machine learning. Thank you.
Myself, Dhruv Chaudhary. I am organizer of BTC with Suyo. Currently, I am working with iCertis as a senior architect. I come from the NLP and NLU background, mostly in information retrieval from last 5 to 6 years. This topic is about Q&A. It's not. We have not created the slides. You'll create a slide for us, and we'll answer that for you. So whether that is an architecture question, that is an algorithmic question, we have academic guy, we have startup guy, we have experience guy, we have architect team. So we all are here, data science guys also. So ask your questions and we'll answer whether that goes into any space or any vector. Yeah, we do have some questions that was there filled in the forms, and we can start with that.
If you want, have any questions?
One question is probably
on the
one
machine learning.
Like,
why did
you miss it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Online
courses,
why did you miss
it?
Online course, any suggestion?
You can start with Andrew.
This is yes. question.
I have shared with him, right?
You should have attended. I mean, it's a very elaborate question.
You want me to reshare on email?
So we covered, I'll be sharing the slide of what. I covered, maybe the guy behind you can explain you. Yes.
Ready?
Yes.
Okay. You open and share do some presentation.
Any other question by that time?
One question to begin with. We know some use cases of text analytics, probably sentiment analysis or something, and probably for image processing, maybe to identify cat or dog thing. But anything for video or any such use cases for different types of data?
So, use cases could be innumerable, frankly. One of the use cases is what we do with CCTV surveillance. It's very time consuming and it's very boring to watch CCTVs all the time.
Correct.
So even when you pay for a movie and you don't like it, you return in half an hour or at max up to interval. So it's highly, you're expecting too much if you want humans to monitor CCTVs basically. So monitoring of CCTVs could be done and alerts could be sent from that live footage if something undesirable is seen to be happening. One of those uses is there. So there are CCTVs everywhere. There could be identification of people jumping from rooftops, jumping from bridges, drowning somewhere in a swimming pool. There could be so many use cases.
So right now, is it a solved problem to identify a particular pattern of movement in a video?
No, it is not a solved problem. It is ongoing research. Frankly, in 2015, the state of the art in computer vision has reached a level where image captioning is describing an image using only software, was achieved by Stanford and Google simultaneously. So 2015 we reached a level of image captioning, but identifying activity and then classifying that activity into harmful or harmless, that is still ongoing research. Recently Google released a very huge data set of activity recognition, so it's still going on and it will take I'm not sure it will take less than two years from now to solve that problem.
But I think that is in the public's place, right? Like,
could you be a bit?
Yeah, I think that is where it is in the public place. Like, I mean, that is the algorithms which are generically available to all. But in the private spaces, I think there are people who are, you know, in the private spaces, there are algorithms being developed. I heard of like the Americans have already a technology or like a patterns where they identify, they look at a person's activity.
Yes, sir.
And they identify that whether, you know, he can do some kind of, you know, bad work or maybe he terrorist also.
Yeah. Well, that
in the private spaces, I think there are.
That activity is not only restricted to
cameras.
That includes bank transactions, that includes travel arrangement, ticketing and those things. That includes basically emails and SMSs and social media. So all these combined, so that is the entire activity. Which in publicly available footage, that is just another modality, you could say.
Like a follow-up question on that is probably like how do we work with the data ingestion part of this? Is just placing a file in HDFS enough, or is there any pre-processing that goes into ingesting this data, video analytics or non-text analytics, right from image to anything else?
There is a lot of pre-processing that happens. In case of images, what happens is most cameras these days are HD, so we have to compress them, and we have to compress them using lossy compression actually. And you just have to make sure that say if you want to recognize a person, at least that many features or that many details remain. You don't want to smoothen it out or, you know, do a compression such that even facial features are lost in a way. So there are a lot of pre-processing techniques.
To make these kind of predictions, do you use VJJ or the Inception V3 kind of models and retrain them and then predict?
Of course. We don't usually do anything from scratch. We always do something that has been researched already. Say for example, one of our interns is here, Ashutosh. Please raise your hand. Yeah, so he worked on a system where we wanted to do robust face detection, and we saw that Google's own API for detecting faces. We had our CCTV cameras in front of road and shops, and some vehicles used to be parked. Tires of those vehicles were detected as faces. So we worked on robust face detection where we made sure that those tires are not detected as faces. And after we completed that, we saw that our system neglected those tires as faces, whereas Google still detects those tires as faces. So in a way, we have done better than Google. But the concentration of Google is not in this niche area. They are a very generic company who provides APIs for purposely taken photographs. Purposely as in photographs which are clicked. In CCTVs, it is not clicked, so no one is actually looking at it. So it is, people are caught inadvertently in the camera. For follow-up questions, if we can, you know, continue later on, because we want to cover the width.
Yes, please. I want to ask a question with where I want like the opinion of you guys. It's a open-ended question. So when we start learning machine learning, it's always supervised learning, unsupervised learning, reinforcement learning. But whenever we make progress or start to understand things for results, it's all supervised learning. Mostly turned in supervised. At least I have worked in supervised mostly. So my question is like, how do you see progress in unsupervised and reinforced learning in coming years? What's your opinion about it?
Most of the things will go on cloud. And what you guys need to know is how to use Azure ML or how to use AWS. Yesterday itself, Google or some Google Auto ML, they are focusing on that technology where you just use the technology to solve the problem. That is where it will go. But perhaps then you need to know how these things work at the back end. All the theory part you need to know what will happen.
I mean, I think this question is not completely answered. But the point is, they are just putting a layer on top of it which automates the thing which normally you do it manually, right? when you are saying auto AML and things like that. And this question is more in terms of
research.
Yeah, in terms of research.
Yes.
Very interesting use case. So the data is sort of unsupervised, we need to unlabel it, the target is only X. This are not there to supervise. Your example, what is called as language modeling. What is language modeling? You have a lot of text written by Shakespeare. How this text is used to build a language model so that the model starts writing like Shakespeare. So this is what is language modeling. The ones that you see in mobile, you start typing something and it predicts the next word. It shows you this is what you type. This is, and you can remember, this is what I typed last time. So it is just string of text. So the way model is built, after say 5 words, 10 words, the next word is given as the label. So it is just X actually. But the X's are converted to Y's per step. So this unsupervised problem becomes supervised. And then you can start. Then we will build a model so which predicts the next word. Once the model is ready, based on the Shakespearean novels, you start with a seed word, it starts spitting out like Shakespeare. So this is the way it works. There's another thing called word to vec. Again, the unsupervised label things is converted to supervised in the sense a middle word and its context. So context is kept as input and the middle word is kept as output. So instead of X's are converted to X and Y's. So this is one of the case where unsupervised is used effectively.
Anything for reinforcement? I would like to add for reinforcement. There is already a model which is trained, and you then again train it according to the use. So like for fail detection and all, there is already some model which is already been trained. So using that model, you tweak it and train it accordingly to your data. So model has already been created and according to your data. For example, you need only specific type of images on which you need to process. So then you can tweak your original model. So that is, you can use reinforcement learning for predicting.
So that's the neural model.
No, not neural. Not using neural networks. Like using machine learning model itself. Yes, reinforcement learning.
So there are two things. You penalize the model or you reward it, and the end goal for the model is to increase the rewards in positive number. So that's how, I mean, frankly speaking, if you follow a scientist called Yang Lekun, a lot of research is right now going on and a lot of debate is also actually going on, where people are saying that deep learning has reached, first it was a hype and now it has reached a stagnancy. And now only anything that has to be done has to go beyond deep learning, whereas people like Yang Lekun and others are stating that deep learning will remain as one of the one of the steps in whatever will come ahead. So it won't just go away. So even if you do reinforcement learning, generative adversarial models or anything else, deep learning will still remain a part of it.
For a site project that I'm doing. So I've been trying, I did something on US style transfer, and I've been trying to replicate handwritings with one font with the other. Like the concept was you give a photo and you give it a style, and you generate a new photo with that style. So what I'm trying to do is, like, we had assignments before, but one person's photo copies and have the assignment just another person handwriting. I always wanted to build that. I've been trying with fonts, but I give it a font, I give it a sample text of my own handwriting, and the text should be in the writing of whatever I've given it. All it does as of now, it just distorts the font and it tries to detect the edges. So I haven't been able to design it the right way. I need some inputs on how do I attack feature engineering. I don't want to go into models because I haven't been able to identify like features yet.
Yeah, you jotted down the steps of the solvers.
So I thought let's create a boilerplate first where I can run multiple experiments. So I have that sorted out. And I thought let's try with a single letter first. First I tried the entire image. Then I have a single character detection. where I'll give a big page of image of A only, and I write my own A in my own handwriting and try to mess that up. So I do have something incremental in my head, but I haven't been able to get to the right model.
So this is basically transfer learning.
Transfer is where you use existing models and features and give it your own.
Yes. So there have been experiments with making photographs just like the paintings of some painters, right?
Exactly.
So this is something very similar. So as far as I am concerned, I have not personally yet worked on that. But from what I get from your statement is that you have developed a system where you are giving one letter each time and it is distorting it to some extent,
yes.
Right? Now, distorting means something is definitely happening.
Yes, it's
okay.
Learning something, but it's
right.
Probably just knowing.
Right. So, could you just tell me what exactly are you doing, steps?
So, I've just done some experiments. I don't have a concrete understanding of what I've been doing.
So, are you using some level of some neural network? Some
yes,
neural
it's a really 16 or 256 that I downloaded, loaded the weights from there, and I'm just dumping it.
Yes. So what you need to, what you need to probably do is research a bit on or find out the codes where they do transfer learning of paintings. Okay. So there is one by Facebook already on GitHub. Okay. Of transfer learning. You need to start with those codes, those samples first. Try to do it on paintings first or images, and then introduce your own images.
So I use the same. So we
yes.
Have 256 the model, which is there is for knowledge and transfer of paintings. I use that model and I'm trying to give it different images of text. So
it's very difficult to study,
right?
Unless we know the steps
of text, right?
Yes.
You have a like somebody has written a pen.
Yes.
And
I have a big written in my writing.
So first is that OCR, it's a OCR problem. So if you understand what a OCR is, optical character recognition.
Right.
So first you have to determine that how you read that text from that thing. So first look at OCR, first try to understand what the OCR is. This itself is a big problem in the industry. So go to any company who is doing extraction of this data, right? They do OCR and it only works at up to 90-95% of accuracy. It doesn't go to 100%. So look at OCR, you will get an answer.
Tesseract is one library which does OCR well. Try out that first. And frankly speaking, it's very difficult to, you know, unless we look at the code and the steps to
code and
kind of predict what exactly is
code
happening.
Code and what you are exactly doing. Your problem statement, you know what the end goal is, but what is not clear is what are the steps you are following.
Right.
So you have to formulate the problem. The problem statement is there with you as the end goal. But how you will, what is the problem statement and what are the steps you are taking, that is critical. For me, according to me, it is an OCR problem.
And maybe design the my solution better than the feedback.
Mm-hmm. More than designing the solution, you design the problem. I mean, I don't know whether you understand this statement.
We have questions already, so I'll finish those and then we can ask them. So the question is, I want to choose ML as my engineering project domain. So which portion of this vast domain could be focused on, in brackets, to get an idea of the projects I'll be working on. So he wanted to do some PE project and is asking which area I should focus. Text, CV, anything.
Of course, I mean, whoever has worked on what, they will recommend that. So we'll be biased. So if someone has worked on text, he'll say text. Someone has worked on CV, he'll say CV.
So rather than student point of view.
Right.
From a student point of view, what I would say, you know, I covered this topic in the morning. Maybe you can think of simple things like building a crawler, you know, that's a simple thing. How a data is collected from the web, be it images or be it text or video. Just understand how a data is collected, see how can you extract data from HTML. That is the first starting point or a project for you guys. Take some, you know, build a crawler for news engine, you know, take all the data from the web, crawl all the news sites from India and store an index and build a search engine. Or even image search or video search.
Udacity's CS101 has excellent resources for this kind of web crawling. They help you build your own search engine. You know.
Who
will
read that?
CS101, Introduction to Computer Science by Udacity. It has a good resource on building your own search engine. basically search engine crawls websites first.
Another way to look at it is you can choose problem or project from your domain. Currently I'm working with mechanical engineering guys in machine learning. So we are trying to build projects which are related to mechanical engineering. So steam plate fault detection. So this is a data set available on this here with all the mechanical engineering parameters and the steam plate was defective or not. So if you start from your domain, you understand where you are coming from, and then the reasons are also interpretable for you. That's another thing. If it just spits out something, it may or may not work. Another thing is there are some hybrid areas like IoT, which is probably going to talk about it. Here it combines embedded systems, some instrumentation, some mechanical engineering thing, and plus CS, normal algorithms. So if you take data sets or problems from that sort of area close to you, then projects in that will be useful to you as a career because you have blend, and plus you understand the outputs well.
I think one would be get the attendance sheet of your colleagues and predict whether he'll attend this class or not. that's the simple thing one can start to predict.
There are very very many low hanging fruits right now in computer vision, frankly speaking. So how many of you know Andrew Ng? Yeah, so those who don't, find out who he is. So he built the Google Brain project. They started recognizing cats for the first time, built a distributed system. He's the founder of Coursera. And recently started deeplearning.ai and landing.ai. Now what landing.ai is doing is it is gathering all these low-hanging fruits in computer vision or in deep learning and basically eating them. So in a way what they are doing is a lot many manufacturing companies, after they manufacture certain product, they have to do inspection of those products. So say for example, if you manufacture a PCB, you have to inspect if it is right or wrong, or it is worth, you know, giving to the customer or not. So for that inspection, earlier everything used to happen manually. If you do this using computer vision, it will be hardly a fraction of a second, and it will also be much more correct than what a human could do. Now, we as Tomatobot are doing the same thing with a company which manufactures chips. So we are doing it for chips right now. So once you do it for one company, you could do it for many more companies who do some kind of manufacturing with very little changes in your code. So there are so many low-hanging fruits that could be eaten up by all of us, and we all still could be much more, you know, healthy with. So no one will remain, you know, starving. So everyone's stomach will be filled. So there's so much to be done. You just have to start somewhere.
Second question is, how to get into the industry? Is deep learning the way ahead? I think none of us thought we'll get into deep learning when we started.
We are deep into it.
So how to get into the industry?
I don't know which industry.
Deep learning is the way, right now it's the way ahead, and that's one of the hottest things that are happening in the industry. There are many business cases that actually the project managers or the project business people are learning how what machine learning can do. Okay, they're slowly gathering all the knowledge, and then they want the technical people to, you know, can we do this, and there is a lot of small team, POCs, if you have department, small things doing everywhere. Okay, so if you want to go ahead, I mean, yes, right now, deep learning is the thing. We no more use machine learning, Apache Moz is no more being used, there are many recommendation systems came, at a time, Apache Moz was the, you know, you should have that keyword in your resume. It's, no one remembers. You know, you don't remember Alta Vista anymore. Alta Vista was at that point better than Google any moment. So yes, deep learning is the way ahead. And in deep learning, there are many things. Like I said, there's computer vision, there's text analytics, there is information retrieval. Let's say now search is everything happening on Lucene, or the can we do search from deep learning? Can we? So there are another people, guys are doing that, trying to solve that problem. So get more than just term to term matching, or even the fancier term matching. Fancier term matching in general, get more than that. Let's say question and answers. So yes, deep learning is the way.
Yes, so there's a professor called Professor Devi Parikh and Professor Dhruv Batra, who are doing question answer, semantic question answering systems. A lot of their students have presented at various NIPS and other conferences on question answer based systems. I think deep learning, as it was first founded in 50s, actually 56 or something around that, that was when people thought that we should do this. Then there were a lot of winters, long winters, like just like in winter is coming in Game of Thrones. So a lot of winters were faced by deep learning. I think it was up to 2012 when the spring began. Actually, 2012 was the time when spring began for deep learning. That was the time when three things came together to see the boom that we are now seeing. First was, we didn't have as much data as we wanted for deep learning. So we started getting that much data. When internet came to our homes and offices, that was when that data came up. Second thing was cheaper computing with GPUs. When we thought that GPUs could be used for deep learning, that's when the hardware requirement was filled. And third, of course, the algorithms. So the algorithms have been, scientists have been developing these algorithms, but they didn't work out earlier because we didn't have enough data or enough computing. So 2012, when DNN Research, one of the companies by Professor Jeffrey Hinton, they used GPUs for a competition on Kaggle. That was when this spring began, actually. So till that time, I don't think, before 2012 or so, even I hadn't heard of deep learning, frankly speaking. But now we have everyone, if any of you are seeking jobs, there are tremendous jobs available right now in India, in Pune, in Bangalore, in Hyderabad, in Mumbai, even in Kochi, in Chennai, and many other two-tier places also, on NLP, on deep learning, on text mining, on data science, as data scientists. So if not for you people, who will grab these jobs? So get started as soon as possible.
So one of the things we are trying to solve in search spaces, we know, search now is term to term matching. Let's start with the basic. Okay, you do fancy term, let's say you take 3 terms, 4 terms, n grams here and there. The problem we are trying to solve with deep learning is, what is a term in itself? How to define a term in itself? What is a term? Out of a text, what is the single term? Is it 2 words, 3 words? Are there 4 words? There are a sentence which is useless. So this is what we are trying to do with insurgents with deep learning.
Questions?
Second is, how does it work? How should we choose an algorithm to apply in its existing system?
I think that's a good question.
So how do we choose an algorithm? Yogesh?
There are generally, I would say, 4 major types of algorithms in machine learning. First is regression, which predicts a real number, floor number. Second one is, anybody? Classification, which predicts class. Third is clustering, grouping. Fourth is association, so depending on the type of problem that you are solving, this is one of these 4 or 5 types. And the algorithms are sort of fixed. If you are doing linear regression, you are not doing classification. So your problem type, whatever you want to achieve, sort of dictates the algorithms of the model that you are trying to do. If you have unlabeled data, you cannot do regression and other things. You have to do with clustering, pattern identification. So your problem dictates the algorithm in some sense.
And if there is a binary classification problem, so we have multiple options available with algorithms, SVM, logistic regression. So in that case, which algorithm will be better?
There are certain characteristics of algorithms. It's sort of shift, there are some biases and variances. Another crude way, for example, you don't understand the mathematics, it is probability, well, is probability based. SVM is margin based. Forget that you don't know anything. There's an SQLN chart available. There are 21 questions guide. So what it says, depending on the size of the data that you have, characteristics, right, directs you, use SVM. Or else use night phase. So that chart is available. For the another rather more scientific answer would be try all. See which one works. Another one is there is something called ensemble, which is a collection of these. 2 plus 2 may be 5 in some case. So there is a way to group algorithms together and see if that works. So all these things can be tried. Tried in the sense of prior data. Let's see if it works.
There is no such thing as, it's not a binary sort or it is not a traditional sorting. No? Most of the places I see, mere paas ye data hai, algorithm bol do, main daal dunga. So you just have to be clear and you have to practice. It is a practice. You try all the algorithms and then see. Generally, my experience says that you have to put at least 2-3 algorithms on top of that model. That is where the ensemble comes in.
I know one company who is trying to solve a problem. There is a problem in humans. Some of them, they don't have water in their eyes. They have a fundamental problem and they have to put drops every hour. And this problem, there is 7% of the population on Earth who has this problem. Now, if they ask what algorithm to apply to solve this, they are no, they are trying. They are trying different ways. They are trying how to detect the nerve. Then they got domain experts. They got eye specialists out there. How to get that? How to sort it? How do you know that there is a problem here? So there is no proper way to this. Second question is, to know more about applications in industrial manufacturing. I think there are many wonderful examples people are doing this. I know a setup in one of the plant in Bajaj. What they are trying to do, they have sensors, IoT sensors on every machine. Let's say a machine which does brake plates. And they are detecting anomalies into that. Whether this machine is malfunctioning or batch coming out of this machine has more number of problems. So they are collecting the data from IoTs, they are collecting the numbers of how much brakes it does in a day, how much heat it generates in a day, whether that heating as compared to others. So rather than checking it manually, they're collecting in the factory, and then they're doing anomaly detection. Temperature, problems in brake as well, let's say the quality is bad, or let's say the machine is other machines are doing more brakes than this machine. So there are many use cases. And in fact, industry gives a whole lot of problem in scaling because I know this factory in itself had 2,000 requests per second that was coming from different machines out there. And it's still very bad to do that. Ask a scaling engineer, 2,000 requests per second is very bad. And there were 2,000 machines. Okay, and so there were 2,000 requests coming every second. Imagine what was be happening in, let's say, Honda or Mercedes, they have many more machines.
I have a follow-up question to that. Would industrial applications be limited to larger setups by virtue of just the volume of data that they could potentially generate? Or is there scope for it to populate down to smaller, medium setup, let's say maybe a couple of hundred people?
So again, that depends on use cases. How they approach was, everything would be handled if people were sitting in Mumbai. They should have a dashboard. They should see what's happening in every factory. Then the technical people told them this is not possible by the number of scale. We can do this by factory. Again, they divided that by department. So only people who were looking at brakes were seeing the brake data, the dashboard. And then they were collecting data from this department and then sending back to the Bombay. So I think business is what drives ultimately the solution. But because of the tremendous data that is coming in, there was another department that was created who were using interconnected data and seeing if there is an anomaly in the area itself, in the factory itself. And other factories are doing good, but this factory is doing bad. Any questions?
how cloud has been used in machine learning. Every day, every bit of it.
This cloud is nothing special, whatever you do. It's compute and storage, which was local before. Now it is somebody else's machine. That's about it. You have some internet connection in between. Of course, it's a very simplistic answer. There are ways to distribute data and then collect the results. But roughly, cloud is nothing but extended laptop.
I think you guys can ask questions
too. I had one question rather to all of you. Like, you guys have worked on good amount of problems. So if each one of you can at least highlight two interesting problem solutions that you have done and dealt with, probably that will give us an idea of what all current problems are there. Of course, without the NDA thing.
I'll only give one. I work in a legal analytics domain. So we have a legal system called as common law system. Meaning, for a judge to judge a case, he has two references. One is what is called a statute, meaning written law, and one is called as precedent, meaning previous cases. You can say this case was dealt with this way, so this case is very similar, so it will be decided similarly. So this is a document similarity problem. But the idea is, these previous court cases may be of varying length, 30 pages, 40 pages. The theme is same, it's a diverse case. But my case is a 5-page case. What the complexity is to find a similarity. The similarity has to be in a meaningful way. Meaning is a very loaded word. Semantic similarity. It's not syntactic similarity. It's not a grammar similarity. So to find the gist of existing cases, then we use something called as word to vec, which sort of says, captures the meaning, and then do cosine similarity of word to vec. So this is how it was solved, very crudely, but it gave reasonable results and it found similar cases. This is what I worked on. Of course, this can be applied anywhere. Similar thing is if you are copying somebody else's essay. It's a similarity assessment. You are just changing the variables in your program and then submitting as assignment, which I have to deal with. So it's easy to catch.
So, Namaskar Prof. And I had two very small problems. One was I worked on a problem where we had to stitch in real time multi-projector training.
Okay, so I'll just tell you what that means. Suppose you have two projections and you want a panoramic image out of these two projections. Okay. So earlier what we could do is put them side by side like this. This would not exactly matter. Then what we thought was, okay, let's overlap some part of that. So then we overlap, for example, this. What happened in this middle part was that the brightness was higher, obviously, in the middle part. And we also wanted it to be stitched and look very seamless. So, now if you look at it from this angle, frontal view in a way. So if this is top view, let's look at it from a frontal view. This is the brightness level, okay. This is the brightness level of first projector. This is the brightness level of second projector. And we wanted something that would, make the brightness level in the overlap part to be one. Okay. And when we detected the overlap part, we had to, decrease the brightness of first projector linearly and increase for the second projector linearly. How many of you think this worked? Any idea? Just guess. You think this worked? No, this didn't work because there is something called as gamma in all. Actually, gamma factor is something that started with CROs and CRT monitors, but somehow it is like an Achilles heel, which is still continuing in LCDs and projectors. So they have a gamma factor, where gamma factor is something like, if this is the actual brightness, the projector projects something like this, and then you apply a variation like this, so that the actual projection and the intended projection are equal. Okay. So because of gamma factor, this didn't work. What used to happen was the brightness used to be like this. So there was a dip in brightness here. I was at that time learning machine learning for the first time, and I came across this function called sigmoid function, which is nothing but like this function. And I applied it here, and it perfectly worked. So I mean, see, this is what innovation is in some way. You learn something somewhere, and you apply it somewhere else, and it works, and you feel good about it, and people appreciate it. So this is how you know, for the first time, machine learning helped me. Well, it was not a machine learning problem, but it helped me. Secondly, as I narrated to you, we worked on detecting faces robustly, which we did better than, in a way, Google. So there are so many manufacturing in the, companies in India who manufacture something or else, and they want to inspect these things. So you could basically do inspection of each and everything. There's recently I read there's a Korean company that does metro scanning after each, you know, periodic audit is needed. So it does this 3D scan of metros, and it finds out if there is some problem. So if you for example employ humans to do it, it would require a month to do it, each and every part, if you employ a few number of people. Whereas a 3D scan would do it in a couple of hours, 4 hours, hence.
So like I said, I work in the information retrieval space. So what we are working right now is, I work on the natural language understanding. So the way we design interfaces, user asks query and we answer it. Now imagine a law firm. Every lawyer has a per rate, a per hour rate, okay? And then few lawyers are well versed in a few laws. Let's say they are expert into environmental law, arbitration law, taxation law, and so they might have the highest rate in environmental law. Second would be, let's say, arbitration law. So if the question is, what is standard rate of John Smith of environmental law? How do you search this? The problem in this statement itself is the term. What is the term? What does user is asking? How, where do you end? What do you start? You say, you know, John Smith, do an NER with Stanford Core, and it can give you a person name, but that is not how simple it is. So that's it. I have to know that this is an important factor, this is an important factor, this is another important factor. So what is a term in itself is what we are trying to solve from deep learning. So we gave the complete data set as a context, okay, then we get user previous queries, what they want, how they are asking. How do you do right now is, you do standard rate or John Smith environmental law, get all the documents that have John Smith environmental law, and then you judge. Okay, where do you find? Business people, you know, imagine there are, in a law firm, there are thousands of cases going on, and John Smith might be working on at least 30 of them, and then he has worked 100 before that. So you will, at a time, at least get, and there are many documents in a case. So imagine you get 3,000 documents, and then you have to find out the standard rate. Or then you have a profile. Go to profile page, go to J, look for John, open his profile and see standard rate. Okay, so what we are doing is, this is a UX problem. We are enriching a user experience where you just ask a question and give back the answer. Now the problem in this is, what is a term? Okay, so this is what we are solving right now. And I can't tell further, I have a lot of ideas. No, but we have solved this completely.
So once you've identified the term, you actually identify what is the profile of JavaScript, go to the page, save the value.
No. That is how it works right now if you don't have this interface. What I'll just tell you the module. The first module is a data meta store. Mm-hmm. Second module is a syntax parser. Third module is a semantic parser. Fifth module is a knowledge graph. Let's say who is expert in environmental law. Now this expert is very domain specific or even very client specific. Let's say a lawyer who has worked many hours is an expert. Business guy will say no, who has earned a lot of money in lesser hours is an expert. So knowledge graph comes after that, then there is a scoring algorithm, and after that, at the end, there is a query formation that takes place. So there are not just one piece. And then every module has many, many tools into that. Metadata store has a graph, knowledge graph has a graph, semantic parser, Elastic is a tool, Spark is a tool for deep learning, for term recognition, TensorFlow, we are using TensorFlow. So many, many. Word to vector is one, sequence to sequence is another. So 30 people working on this. Just what is a term? And there are recently many research papers that are coming out.
Yeah, so one major problem that I solved, I mean, that was part of the solution business problem was we wanted to tell fund managers what stock to invest. So the entire pipeline was built, I mean, right from doing the data to clustering classification, doing deduplication, and then rating and ranking the articles. And we told the fund manager that this is what you can invest in. And in that one portion was when we were crawling, it was pre-Hadoop and Spark Herald. So to scale the crawl, we used Nash Equilibrium. We had 9 servers running on to crawl the data, right? So what we did was there is some person called Satish Panmatsa. So he's a game theory, written papers on game theory. And there we took, basically Nash Equilibrium, if anybody knows, it tells that when you are playing a game, basically you can win but others cannot lose. Something like this. So we put some model and we wrote some code, and that code was running on all the machines, and we ensured that when we distributed the data, there are some analytics modules that were implemented to see what news articles were coming very frequently and what was not coming frequently. And we ensured that at any given point in time, all the servers had the same amount of crawls that needs to be done every X minute. If you go and recheck, you rebalance all the servers and ensure that at all given point in time, we used to reallocate how the crawl runs. So that is one major problem, and by doing this, we saved another 20 servers. You know, the management was willing to give us take 20 servers and run the code, but we did not want to manage servers, so we solved this problem. Another problem I solved was what, if you see any documents, right, you have in Word documents, there's a sections and subsections. But generally when people write documents, you do not know where, they don't use the headers, header 1, header 2. But we wanted to create sections from subsections, which we called it as bit. So we wrote some machine learning techniques using random forest or some decision trees to identify these sections. You know, we identified whether it is bold, underlined, italics. So we did this iteration and we found sections. Generally this is used when you have RFPs or something and you want to give the same document to other companies, you want to copy paste some portions and you want to write some new portions, right? So we built a model to read the RFP documents and then tell them what is a bit in this content. So that was done using decision tree.
I think that's it. Our time is up. Other guys are coming. Any last question?
What was the accuracy of the stock prediction? So you were suggesting stocks for.
So we wanted to target 4 out of 10. The
the manually they were doing 3 out of 10. So we wanted to be 3.5 out of 10.
For that second or for that hour?
The number of stocks, like if we buy product, 4 out of 10 stocks, we were predicting it correctly. That was enough to earn billions. And dollars.
Thank you,
Ramesh. Thank you.